All right, good morning, everyone, and welcome back to our live stream Bible class from Bethlehem Lutheran Church in Germantown in Menominee Falls, Wisconsin. We thank you for joining us as we continue our study of the book of beginnings, the book of Genesis, and we're looking especially now at the life of Abram, or Abraham, the great father of faith, looking at the ups and downs of his life of faith, and seeing how we can draw lessons for our own lives of faith out of his experiences, but most importantly, seeing how God is at work in and through this Old Testament patriarch to bring about and further the messianic promises that he has begun in the beginning of the book of Genesis and will continue to carry out throughout the Old Testament. So those are kind of the two focuses we're always trying to remind ourselves as we think about Abraham, certainly trying to draw some lessons for our own lives of faith out of his experiences, but remembering that the story of Abraham is not so much a story of Abraham, but a story of God working through Abraham for God's own purposes. We're going to be picking up in the lesson that we started with last week, which is lesson two, and it covers, it's called Fear and Faith, and it covers Genesis 12, 10 through 13, 18. Last week we covered the Genesis chapter 12, verses 10 through 20, which was a very negative story and a negative part of the Abraham story when Abraham goes down to Egypt because of the flood. And or because of the famine, sorry, the famine in the promised land. He goes down to Egypt and he tells this half truth, half lie about his wife Sarai so that he would be treated well for her account. And in that sense, the plan works, but there is an unexpected twist, an aspect of the plan that Abram doesn't expect to have happen, which is that the Lord strikes Pharaoh and his household with diseases for Sarah's sake, in order to protect her chastity. And he ends up kind of being escorted out of Egypt, but escorted out of Egypt richly blessed with the tremendous amount of worldly wealth that he didn't have going down to Egypt. And so we saw in the beginning of chapter 12, we saw Abraham's life, faith life, I mean, kind of end on a high note with his traveling to the promised land, even though he didn't know where he was going, and worshiping the Lord there and calling on the name of the Lord, living among the Canaanites as an exile. And then we have this low point at the end of chapter 12 with the debacle in Egypt. And now we're going to look at chapter 13, verses 1 to 18, where Lot and Abram decide to separate, and we're going to see Abram's life on the uptick again. We're going to see his faith life doing well again. We're going to see him trusting God again and being blessed richly because of it. So that's going to kind of be the plan for today. We're going to look at this section, Genesis chapter 13, verses 1 through 18, the splitting of Abram and Lot. So the lesson was posted again, reposted in the Facebook feed. You should be able to scroll just below this video and find the lesson that was the same lesson that was posted last week. We're going to be picking up on question number 9, so the back side or page 2, if you're following along electronically, page 2, kind of near the bottom of the page with question number 9. But let's begin our study of the word with prayer. So we pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we know that you bring your Easter blessings to us through the proclamation of your word that you explained to those confused and scared, frightened disciples. You explained to them from the scriptures how everything that had to happen was fulfilled in your life, death, and resurrection. And we ask that you would be with us and speak to us through your word today, that you might take away our doubts and our fears, that you would remind us of your never-ending and abiding presence and blessing, and that you would create in us such lives of faith that we are willing to act and behave in a way that is in keeping with the priorities and the principles of a Christian life that you have laid out for us in your holy word. Open our eyes to see wonderful things in your word. We ask this in all things in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so like I said, coming off of a kind of a low moment in Abram's life with the deception of Sarah, the deception of Egypt and Sarah. But now we can kind of move forward with the next kind of high moment in his life, which is the separation of him and Lot. So let's go ahead and just read. We can kind of divide this section of Genesis 13 into two halves. So verses 1 through 9 and then verses 10 through 18. So let's go ahead and read verses 1 through 9. So Abram went up from Egypt to the Negev with his wife and everything he had, and Lot went with him. Abram had become very wealthy in livestock and in silver and gold. And again, that wealth comes at least in part from the blessing of, or the Lord's blessing of Abram through Pharaoh. From the Negev, he went from place to place until he came to Bethel, to the place between Bethel and Ai, where his tent had been earlier, and where he had first built an altar. There Abram called on the name of the Lord. Now Lot, who was moving about with Abram, also had flocks and herds and tents. But the land could not support them while they stayed together, for their possessions were so great that they were not able to stay together. And quarreling arose between Abram's herders and Lot's. The Canaanites and Perizzites were also living in the land at that time. So again, another note about competition over resources, right? This is a possessed land, and Abram and Lot are living as nomads. They're living as strangers, as foreigners in this land, and natural resources are scant. And now Abram and Lot are so richly blessed that the land can't support the flocks of both of them while they're staying together. So verse 8. So Abram said to Lot, "Let's not have any quarreling between you and me or between your herders and mine, for we are close relatives. Is not the whole land before you? Let's part company. If you go to the left, I'll go to the right. If you go to the right, I'll go to the left." So that takes us to where we're going to stop for this lesson. So, or for this section. So we'll look at going back to our sheet now, looking at number 9. Why do you think Abram goes directly from Egypt to Bethel? And remember, and we have this note in verse 3 and 4. That Bethel is when Abram arrives in the promised land. Bethel is the very first place that he builds an altar to the Lord. So when he's coming back from Egypt, he makes his, he kind of goes from place to place, but eventually he makes his way to Bethel, this place where he first built an altar to the Lord. And what might this action indicate about Abram's heart? And again, is this reading between the lines? Yeah, it's reading between the lines a little bit. I know that the text doesn't actually come right out and say that this is what Abram was thinking or this is what was going on in Abram's heart. And yet, I think it's very likely that this trip to Bethel is an act of repentance. That this is Abram's way of saying or recognizing or confessing that he had done something wrong when he was down in Egypt, and that now it's time to restore his broken relationship with God. It's time to get back on track, spiritually speaking. It's time to get get back to a right relationship with God. And so he goes to Bethel, this place where he had first built an altar in the Promised Land. And there he again calls on the name of the Lord. He again to kind of reestablishes or reconnects his relationship with God. So I think you have an intentional action of Abram here. This isn't just a mistake, or this isn't just him kind of retracing his steps, even though he is doing that. But this is really Abram intentionally taking a symbolic action that is meant to reflect his penitence, his repentance for his mistake in Egypt, for his mess up in Egypt with Sarah and his wife. And so I think that's really what we ought to see going on in Abram's heart with his return to Bethel, is this is an act of repentance. This is an act of contrition on Abram's part, a desire to reestablish his relationship with God. And so he goes back to kind of where it all started with God in the Promised Land at Bethel, where he sets up his, where he first set up an altar there. Number 10 on our sheet, what problem arises in this episode, and how is it similar to the problem that arose in Genesis chapter 12, verse 10? Well, the problem that arises here, in one sense, the problem is opposite, and in another sense, the problem is the same. The problem is opposite in the sense that Abram and Lot, remember, God had promised Abram that whoever is connected with Abram will be richly blessed. So whoever blesses you, I will bless. Whoever curses you, I will curse. So if you stay close to Abram, if you stay connected to Abram, then you will be blessed by God. And Lot, his nephew, has decided to stay close to Abram, to travel with Abraham, to go from place to place with him. And so Lot is enjoying the blessings of God just like Abram is enjoying the blessings of God. And so both of their herds are becoming so large, they're becoming so blessed by God that it's impossible for the land to support both of them. Remember that they're nomads, they're shepherds, they have flocks, so they need space, they need pasture, they need water, they need wells. These are the kinds of natural resources that they need in order to keep their flocks alive. This is how they measure their wealth, is in terms of flocks. And so God has richly blessed both Abram and Lot with a tremendous number of flocks. But because of that, and because the Promised Land just isn't that rich a land. It isn't a paradise. And so there's a strain on natural resources. So what happened in 12 verse 10 was there was a strain on natural resources that was caused by the famine, right? There's kind of this environmental disaster that causes the famine that leads Abram to take his family down to Egypt. Here, there's no kind of environmental disaster. The problem is, the quote unquote problem, is that Abram and Lot are so richly blessed that the land isn't able to support both of them. So again, you have this issue of the scarcity of natural resources. And that's why, Moses notes that in addition to Abram and Lot and their flocks, you also have the Canaanites and the Perizzites that are living in the land. So it isn't just between the two of them, but they're trying to navigate their lack of natural resources with the people who happen to be living in, who are permanent residents in the land, people that actually own the land. Remember that they were, as nomads, they were in some sense kind of dependent on the kindness of strangers. But that isn't that in a situation where your flocks are so richly blessed that the land can't support you, Then all of a sudden that the kindness of strangers is going to dry up. So the problem that arises in this episode, that's really the same problem that arises in chapter 12, is there's a scarcity of natural resources. Abram doesn't know how he's going to take care of himself and of his flocks, because the land just can't support both him and Lot. So here is, but here's where the rubber meets the road, right? So we have Abram in a very similar situation that he was in chapter 12. Is he going to have learned his lesson from chapter 12? Is he, remember in chapter 12, there's this famine in the promised land, and he doesn't respond in faith. He responds out of weakness of faith, or responds in unbelief. And he goes down to Egypt and he lies to protect his own skin. So Abram doesn't do the right thing in response to the challenge to his faith that the circumstances provide. Is he going to make that mistake again? So I'm looking now at number 11 on the sheet. How is Abram's response to this problem strikingly different from the way that he responded to the problem in Genesis 12, verses 10 to 20? Remember, in Genesis 12, Abram was only interested in himself. He's interested in protecting himself and his own resources. He's interested in protecting his own flock, or his own skin. He's willing to sacrifice his wife up to the harem of Pharaoh in order to protect his own skin, his own well-being. But when it comes to this conflict, or this need to separate from Lot, notice how self-sacrificing Abram has become. Knowing and trusting that God is going to take care of him, knowing and trusting that God will provide, Abram is exceedingly generous to Lot. So I'm looking at verse 8. So Abram said to Lot, "Let's not have any quarreling between you or me, or between your herds and mine. We are close relatives. Is not the whole land before you?" So here's Abram's solution to the problem. The land can't support Lot and Abram's flocks being together, so he gives Lot the choice. Lot, you pick the direction you want to go. If you want to go left, then you go left and I'll go right. If you want to go right, then you go right and I'll go left. Which you go wherever you want to go in the promised land, and I will go the other direction. So there's this tremendous generosity. Again, as the patriarch of the household, as the head of the household, as the ruling father of the household, Abram would have had every right to pick for himself which direction he was going to go. He would have had every right to say, "I'm going this way, and Lot, you're going that way." But Abram actually leaves the choice up to Lot. And this is a beautiful sign, or a beautiful evidence of Abram's faith in God to provide. Abram knows that regardless of what direction he goes, God will graciously provide for him. Abram's not worried about whether or not God is going to provide for him. God has proven in the previous episode, at the end of chapter 12, that even when Abram does what's wrong, God is going to richly provide for him. So if that's the case when Abram does what's wrong, how much more isn't God going to provide when Abram does what's right? So we have the same, in a sense, the same situation arises, a scarcity over resources, but we have a completely different response from Abram. Whereas before his response was one of unbelief, or maybe we'll be kinder and say a weakness of faith. Abram leaves the promised land. Abram goes down to Egypt. Abram lies about Sarah in order to protect himself and his own skin. And from but now he stays in the promised land. He trusts that God will provide for him, and he gives Lot the opportunity to choose whichever direction that he wants to go. And that'll be and that's a reflection of Abram's faith. So what we really see going on is we have a beautiful example of a child of God learning from a past failure. The disaster of chapter 12 turns into the great victory of chapter 13. Okay. So, with that in mind, let's go ahead and finish the chapter. So we're going to look at verses 10 through 18. How did this end up playing out? This letting Lot choose the direction. So this is verses 10 to 18. Lot looked around and saw that the whole plain of the Jordan towards Zoar was well watered, like the garden of the Lord, like the Garden of Eden. Like the land of Egypt. Remember, Egypt isn't dependent on rainfall. Its value, or the farmable land, is caused by the overflowing of the Nile, right? So it's fertility. That's the word I was looking for. The fertility is not based on rainfall, but is based on the overflowing of the Nile. So he looks out over at the plain of the Jordan out west towards Zoar, and he sees, this is like the garden of the Lord. This is like Egypt. This is a rich and prosperous land. And then we have this little note from Moses. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So a little hint about what's coming up. That this land that is so well watered now isn't always going to be that. And even at the time of Moses, when he wrote these books, that wasn't the case. So why is it different? Well, we're going to read about that story later. So since the plain of the Jordan was well watered, like the garden of the Lord, and like Egypt, so Lot chose for himself the whole plain of the Jordan and set out toward the east. The two men parted company. Abram lived in the land of Canaan, while Lot lived among the cities of the plain and pitched his tents near Sodom. Now the people of Sodom were wicked and were sinning greatly against the Lord. The Lord said to Abram after Lot had parted from him, "Look around from where you are to the north and south, to the east and west. All the land you see, I will give to you and your offspring forever. I will make your offspring like the dust of the earth, so that if anyone could count the dust, then your offspring could be counted. Go, walk through the length and breadth of the land, for I am giving it to you." So Abram went to live near the great trees of Mamre at Hebron, and he pitched his tents. There he built an altar to the Lord. So just some questions I have here. Number 12, sorry, number 12, so at the top of page 3. What two things about the plain of the Jordan are emphasized by Moses, and on which basis did Lot make his decision? So there are two different things that are emphasized about that plain in this section of scripture. So one of the things is the great fertility of the area, right? That this is a well-watered plain. That this is the kind of place that this is the kind of a dream location for a herdsman to go, because the place is well watered. This is a place where his flocks could be supported. There isn't a scarcity of natural resources here. There's an abundance of resources. So it's a very good place to be. It's a very pleasant place materially. From a materialistic perspective, it's a very positive place. But from a spiritual perspective, it's a very negative place, because the people of Sodom are wicked and were sinning greatly against the Lord. So Lot had a choice between a place that was materially prosperous and spiritually wicked. And he chose the material over the spiritual. He chose to live where there was spirit, where there was material prosperity, even though this is a land of spiritual wickedness, of spiritual weakness. And of course, this is going to come back to haunt Lot on multiple occasions and multiple ways. This poor choice, choosing the material over the spiritual, is going to come back to haunt Lot in multiple ways. First, when he gets captured by the coalition of Chedorlaomer, and then, of course, when the Lord brings his judgment against Sodom and Gomorrah for their wickedness, Lot gets caught up in that, but he has no one to blame but himself, because he's the one that chose to live there. He chose to be where the material blessings were, even though that brought spiritual consequences, even though it had negative spiritual consequences. So you have those two things, material and spiritual, materially blessed but spiritually cursed. Lot makes his decision on the basis of the material. And even though, this is the story of the life of Abraham, or Abram, this is, Abram's close relative Lot, and we can learn a negative lesson from Lot too. Now, it isn't always a choice between material good and spiritual evil. In fact, I'd say that that usually isn't the case. It isn't always a sin to choose the material prosperity. But when we choose material prosperity at the expense of spiritual health, when those two things go hand in hand, when spiritual and material prosperity means putting yourself in spiritual danger, well, then we do make a mistake by choosing material prosperity. So we always have to be careful to consider all of the ramifications of the decisions that we make. That it's not that we're not just looking at the quote unquote bottom line, but that we're focused on everything. We're focused on the whole picture, of what is being of what the consequences of our decisions are. Because we can make a decision that is good for us materially, but if we make a decision that's negative for us spiritually, then we just shoot ourselves in the foot. It doesn't do any good to be materially blessed and spiritually cursed, or the way that Jesus says that is, what good is it for a man to gain the whole world and yet lose his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? Or do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where rust and moth destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. So again, not that it's wrong to make a decision based on material prosperity, but when it's a choice between material prosperity and spiritual prosperity, we want to make sure that we have a balanced perspective of things. We want to make sure that we're valuing the spiritual above the material. And Lot is a negative example of someone who chose the material instead of the spiritual. Okay, so that was number 12 on our sheet. Number 13. Why would God's words have to Abram in Genesis 13:15 have been a surprise to him? How is the command in verse 17 a small test of Abram's faith? Well, first of all, let's just review the words that are in verse 13:15. So the promise that he makes is that all the land you see, I will give to you and your offspring forever. Why would that have been a surprise to Abram? Well, remember that that land is occupied. That land is being controlled by the Perizzites and the Canaanites. That he has just ceded that land to Lot and to his family. And so to say that that his descendants are going to own every part of the land that he can see, that would have been quite an amazing or surprising promise to Abram. And this instruction for Abram to walk through the length and the breadth of the land, to kind of explore the land, so to speak. We kind of have a foreshadowing of what Joshua and Caleb and the spies are going to do later in the story of Moses. He's going to travel throughout the land and see what the land is like. See what the land that God is giving his descendants is like. That is a little test of faith, in the sense that he's asking Abram to trust that he is going to cause everything to work out according to his plan, that he's going to cause things to work for Abram's good, that he's going to cause this promise to be fulfilled, that Abram would be would or his descendants anyway are going to own that promised land. So he's going to travel the land as a foreigner or as a visitor, kind of in anticipation of the day when he will receive the land as its owner. His descendants will receive the land as an owner. So little test of faith. God says, walk through that land, walk through the promised land, and see the land that I have promised to give to you and to your ancestors. Okay, I think that's pretty much all that I have to say about those verses. So let's go ahead and look at that for further thought and discussion questions. Number 14, when read together, and what I mean by when read together, I mean the episode in chapter 12 and the episode in chapter 13. So the episode in Egypt, which is the weakness of Abram's faith, and now the episode with his parting with Lot, the strength of Abram's faith. How do these episodes, when read together, present us with a picture of faith as it really is? And we talked a little bit about this in the introduction last week when we talked about the Apostle Peter. But faith as it really is, faith is not some static thing. It's not that our faith just stays the same every day. Sometimes it feels that way. But other times I think we feel very acutely that our faith is kind of on a roller coaster ride, that it has ups and downs, that we have good days of faith and we have not so good days of faith. You see an example of that in Abram and in his and these early experiences in his life as the father of the faithful. That he's got this high moment at the middle of chapter 12, and he's got this low moment at the end of chapter 12, and now he's back up on a high moment with letting his light shine and letting his faith dictate his actions and his behavior. So this is faith as it really is. Faith is an up and down. Faith is not a static thing. It changes from day to day. It has weaknesses and strengths. It ebbs and flows. It's important for us as the people of God to remember when we're having a bad faith day, kind of like a bad hair day, but when you're having a bad faith day, that we don't necessarily beat ourselves up and say, what kind of strange thing is happening here? This is just the way that life in a sinful world works. That we're going to have challenging days. We're going to have days that we don't trust the way that we know we ought to. And we run to God in such circumstances for forgiveness and for peace. We remember that our Savior went to the cross to take away all of our sins, including all the times that we have had imperfect faith. All of our bad faith days, those days too have been covered by the cross of Jesus. And when we're having a good faith day, when we're having a strong faith day, we don't boast. We're not prideful about that because we know that's only an entirely a gift from God. It's only because of what God has done for us, what God is doing in us, that we are blessed with that day. But again, what I think is beautiful, as we study the characters on the pages of Scripture, like Abraham, is that we don't get this unreasonable picture of what Abraham is like on the pages of the Bible. We don't get this perfect believer depicted before us who never had any struggles with his faith. We see Abram with the warts and all, with the weaknesses of the faith and all. This is the way that faith really is. It's an up and down thing. It's a day-to-day thing. Jesus teaches us to pray, "Give us today our daily bread." Jesus says, "Don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow has enough worries of its own." It's just a matter of taking things a day at a time and trusting in God to provide a day at a time. And that's what, that's what being a Christian is all about. That's what living a Christian life is all about. That's what the challenge of living a Christian life is all about. It's about trusting God, about learning how to trust God on a daily basis, taking our failures to Him, and relying on Him, and giving Him the glory and the credit on our good days as well. So on good days or bad, whether on good days or bad days, we flee to the Lord and we find our help, our strength, our comfort in Him and in Him alone. And then the last discussion question that I have for this lesson, number 15, why is it so easy to say I trust in Christ as my Savior, but so difficult to say I trust in Christ as my provider? And then how do we overcome these difficulties? And maybe you'd want to say, well, maybe it's not always so easy to say that I trust in Christ as my Savior. But my guess is that if I were to do an interview with 100 members of our congregation and I were to say, "Do you believe that Jesus Christ is your Savior? Are you confident that Jesus is your Savior, that your sins have been taken away?" That there would be a lot of high confidence responses to that question. This is the heart and core of what we believe, and this is what we talk about on a frequent we talk about frequently. This is the focus of our public worship services and in our sermons, because it is the focus of the Bible. It's the focus of the message of the Word of God, that our sins have been taken care of, our sins have been taken away, we've been washed clean, we've been justified before God, declared not guilty in His sight. We are sanctified. We're set apart to be new people, to be new creations, to have a holy purpose. And we just get used to of recognizing that Christ is our Savior from sin. Maybe the other kind of factor that goes into this is that, salvation is invisible. You can't really put salvation out there. You can't quantify salvation. You can't measure God's forgiveness. You can measure God's material blessings, right? You can measure how well or maybe not well God is providing for you. So when it comes to faith, we're talking about kind of things that are not measurable, things that are not visible. Whereas when you're talking about material blessings, you're talking about things that are measurable, things that you can quantify. And so we look around and we can and they're visible. So we can see the different ways that God may not be providing for us. We can see there are these things that we want or things we think we need that God, in His wisdom and love, have chosen not to give to us. And it's easier, it's more difficult in the face of seeing those things to believe that God is going to be our provider. So it's easy to say, "Yeah, I know God, I know that you're my Savior. I know that in Christ you've taken away my sins." But we kind of fret and worry about our material possessions. We kind of fret and worry about, are we going to have enough? Is our 401k going to be big enough? Is it going to last us our lives? Are we going to have enough money to fund the ministry of the congregation? Are we gonna have are we gonna have enough materialistic blessings to move forward in ministry the way that we want to? It's easy to trust in God as Savior, but it's not so much easy. It's not. It's much more difficult. It takes much more faith, or it takes. It's an exercise of faith to trust in God as provider. And that's really what we see is going on so beautifully in Abram's example here in Genesis 13. His trusting God as provider is that he's willing to say to Lot, look, if you want to go left, then I'll go right. If you want to go right, I'll go left, because I know that either way, I know that God is gonna provide for us. I know that God is gonna keep me. God is going to richly provide for me. So he has that confidence not only in God as Savior, but in God as provider. So I hope that kind of clarifies the question, what I mean when I say, why is it easy to say that God is Savior, but maybe not so easy to say that God is provider, especially when it seems like our physical needs are not being met. Then it's easy to doubt whether or not God is kind of being the provider that he promises that he will be. But the more important question in that discussion question is the second one, right? How do we move forward, or how do we overcome the difficulty? And the way that the scriptures encourage us to do this is to play the from the greater to the lesser game. Now, arguing from the greater to the lesser is a rhetorical device where you say, God has done this greater thing, and if God has shown himself willing and able to do the greater thing, don't you think that he's able and willing to do the lesser thing too? And the most famous example of this comes from Romans chapter 8, where the Apostle Paul says that if God did not spare his one and only Son, but gave him up for us all, okay, that's the greater thing. God has given us the greatest gift that he has to give. He's given us the gift of his Son. If God did not spare his Son, but graciously gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? If God is so loves us and is so concerned with us that he meets our greatest need, the need for the forgiveness of sins, even though it cost him his greatest good, it cost him giving up his Son, then why shouldn't we be certain that he is going to meet all of our physical needs too? Compared to our spiritual needs, our daily physical needs are just, a drop of God's almighty hat. So then you can think about other passages, where Jesus says, Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount says, think about the birds of the air. They don't sow fields, and they don't store away in barns, and yet your Heavenly Father feeds them. How much more valuable are you? And or how about the grass of the field, which is here today and gone tomorrow? Even Solomon in all his splendor was not dressed as in much glory as one of these, and yet you are much more valuable than they, right? So you have that same kind of argument that. That God, if God is able to take care of the birds and the grasses of the field, and we are much more valuable than they, then God will take care of us too. So we look at the character of God. We look at what God has done for us in Christ. We look at how God has met our greatest need, the need for forgiveness, the need for salvation. And knowing that he has taken care of our greatest need, we can rely, we can trust that he will take care of our lesser needs, that he will take care of our physical needs too. And so we can pray with confidence, as the Lord has taught us in the Lord's Prayer, give us this day our daily bread. We can make that prayer with confidence, knowing that God, who is in heaven and who has all glory and power and authority and majesty and might, is more than able and capable, of providing for our daily bread. And just like we trust that God is our Savior and our Redeemer, just like we trust in Him as the one who takes away our sins, so too we can have that very same confidence that He is the one who will richly and daily provide for my daily needs. And I think that this little example in Abraham's life, where he's willing to say to Lot, if you go right, I'll go left. If you go left, I'll go right. That's a beautiful example of the kind of trust a believer has in God's ability to provide regardless of what situation life may throw in our direction. Okay, so we're going to call that lesson done. When we come back next week, God willing, we will pick up with chapter 14, which is Abram rescuing Lot from Chedorlaomer's coalition as he comes in and captures Sodom and Gomorrah. So we'll see how God intervenes in world history, in the interaction of nations for the sake of His Son and the sake of the promise of the Savior. So thank you for joining us for Bible study this morning. We pray that you are built up in your faith and reminded of God's tremendous love and care and concern for you, both spiritually and physically. And we pray that you're able to join us again next week for our continuing Bible class on the life of Abraham. Let's close with the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with us always. Amen. Thank you very much, and God's blessings to all of you.